Good morning. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is general questions. Question number one, I call John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will give an assurance that Glasgow Kelvin and Clyde Colleges will not be taken over by the City of Glasgow College in connection with the review of tertiary education.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Scottish Government accepts the Scottish Funding Council's review recommendation that Glasgow College's Regional Board and their three assigned colleges explore other organisational options. There is no proposal for City of Glasgow College to take over the other two colleges, and we have no plans for such. I expect a recommendation from the SFC in the future of Glasgow College's Regional Board shortly.
John Mason.
Well, I thank the Minister for that answer and I find it encouraging. And I just wonder if he would accept that there really are quite different roles for these colleges, that City of Glasgow is at a different level, it's aiming at a different clientele, whereas Kelvin and Clyde are very much community-based and helping people who are far away from the educational background.
Minister.
What I would say to Mr Mason, I like the activity that each college is doing. I do think they make a distinct contribution. They are all engaged with their communities. I have to say, actually, all three colleges are doing well in terms of the proportion of HE entrants from the 20% quartile of the SIMD areas that we are seeking to target. All of them are ahead in that regard, particularly Clyde and Kelvin colleges. Whatever recommendation comes from the SFC, I don't want to see the distinct contribution and the loss of community engagement happening, and that's the manner in which I'll approach these matters.
Question number two, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to support ecological status of Scotland's lochs and rivers.
Minister Lorna Slater.
Thank the member for that question. Scotland's River Basin Management Plan set out the Scottish Government's continued commitment to a wide range of measures that are protecting and improving the ecological status of our rivers and lochs. Actions already underway include ensuring good agricultural practice is adopted and investment in public wastewater infrastructure to improve water quality. Achievement of the objectives set out in the plans is a shared responsibility between the Scottish Government, the Scottish Environmental Protection Agency, local authorities and other public bodies and regulated businesses such as Scottish Water, Agriculture, Fish Farms, Distilleries and Hydropower.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Minister for her answer, but will she agree that the recent assessment by CEPA has found that Scottish rivers, lochs, canals and burns are in the worst state on record? Does the Minister intend to bring forward urgent plans in order to address this dreadful situation?
Minister.
It is not correct to say, as was reported on the 22nd of October, that Scotland's rivers and lochs are in the worst state on record. The number of water bodies awarded a bad overall ecological status by CEPA fell from 126 in 2018 to only 64 in 2019. CEPA's monitoring and assessment of the water environment shows that the number of rivers and lochs rated as bad or poor due to pollution is at its lowest level ever. Just 1% were classified in this way in 2019.
Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Government made a partial U-turn on allowing raw sewage to be dumped into rivers and coastal waters only after their MPs came under extreme criticism. Scotland undertakes around 80% of the UK's tree planting and was one of the first nations in the world to declare a climate emergency. Does the Minister therefore share my view that this SNP government needs no instruction from the Tories on how to conduct itself when it comes to the environment?
Minister.
Thank you. I thank the member for that question. 87% of our water environment is now at good water quality, and this is hard evidence that this government has taken its environmental responsibilities seriously for many years.
Willie Rennie.
There have been several instances of pollution in the River Eden in my constituency over recent years, with the death of many fish and the impact on wildlife as well. Does the Minister think that CEPA have sufficient resources and authority to enforce the environmental law? And has she considered whether wildlife crime officers could have a role in this in addition.
Minister.
I'm happy to meet with the member to thank you, member, for the question. I'm happy to meet with the member to look into this matter further. Thank you.
Question number 3, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports the climate tech industry.
Minister Tom Arthur.
A vibrant tech sector is critical to our economic recovery and net zero ambitions. Through the implementation of the Scottish Technology Ecosystems Review, the Scottish Government is committed to creating a world-class technology ecosystem, enabling a pipeline of profitable, scalable tech businesses, including climate tech businesses. This year, we have allocated £7 million to support the first-year implementation of the review. This includes establishing a national network of tech scalers, which will support 300 to 500 tech companies through the Tech Scalers programme. Other policy interventions include our recent artificial intelligence strategy, which set out an action to build on the success of our AI Climate Emergency Challenge, which saw 6 companies develop their concepts to use AI to help address the climate emergency. The Scottish Government is also supporting challenges through the CivTech 6, which explore the roles that tech can play in carbon sequestration, an important tool in getting to net zero.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? In the Innovation Critical Report by SCDI, BT, Scotland IS and the Royal Society, they tell us that up to 75% of the emissions reductions we need to get to help us get to net zero depend on technologies that are either immature, not deployed at scale, or haven't even been invented yet. Can the Minister assure me that Scotland's tech industries, who have major strengths in climate tech, are getting the support that they need to help them develop these solutions, not just for Scotland, but to contribute to the global efforts to get us to net zero?
Minister.
Can I thank Willie Coffey for that question and his consistent interest in this area? I agree with him absolutely. There's huge potential in this area. I think there's 2 points I would make. There's 1, supporting industry itself, and I made reference to that in my original answer with our Tech Scalers programme. But there's also supporting the industries who will use these technological interventions. And we have, for example, committed over £2 billion in capital investment over the course of this Parliament to deliver low-carbon and natural infrastructure. So climate tech cuts across a range of businesses, so there's a support for businesses themselves, and there's a support for the wider mission to a just transition to net zero, which will drive the economy for those particular tech startups.
Question number 4, Eleanor Whittam.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the measures it has been taking to protect and enhance the marine environment through no-take zones and marine protected areas.
Minister Lorna Slater.
I thank the member for the question. The Marine Protected Area Network now covers 37% of our seas following recent designations, including the Red Rocks and Longay Urgent MPA for the critically endangered flapper skate. Most sites already have the required protective measures in place, and we have committed to putting in place further fisheries management measures on MPAs, where required, by March 2024. We have also committed to designating 10% of our waters as highly protected marine areas by 2026. These will provide a higher level of protection, providing for additional recovery and enhancement of the marine environment.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Clyde has led in establishing no-take zones under the current SNP government. I understand that Ayrshire proposes to undertake a scoping exercise regarding a 30% no-take zone along the eastern coastline of the Clyde, which includes the coast of Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley. I would be grateful to the Minister for advice on what supports this project can expect to receive from the Scottish Government in line with COP26, endorsing Scotland's lead in addressing both climate change and biodiversity loss through marine protected areas.
Minister.
Thank you very much for this question. The development of highly protected marine areas goes beyond no-take zones by providing for the strict control or exclusion of all human activities, not just fishing. The Scottish Government will be developing a policy framework for HPMAs in the coming months and will ensure that the wide-ranging perspectives of all marine stakeholders are taken into account throughout the selection and designation process. We would encourage all stakeholder interests with proposals to manage inshore fisheries to develop these measures within the relevant regional inshore fisheries group. I'd be very happy to meet with Ms. Whittam to discuss activity in the Ayrshire coast further.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The only no-take zone in Scotland is, of course, in my own constituency in Lammarsh Bay. And I was just wondering what the difference is between a no-take zone and a highly protected marine area.
Minister.
The proposals for developing the details around highly protected marine areas are still under development. We're working on a policy framework for these HPMAs in the coming months. And we absolutely need to make sure that the wide range of perspectives from all marine stakeholders are taken into account. So I look forward to presenting that information, or one of my colleagues to presenting that information to Parliament in the months ahead.
Question number 5, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that Barr Environmental has received a £99 million fine for having not paid tax on disposed waste.
Minister Tom Arthur.
It would not be appropriate for Scottish ministers to comment on any individual tax dispute. The collection and management of the fully devolved taxes are a matter for Revenue Scotland in its role as Scotland's independent tax authority.
Sharon Dowie.
I thank the Minister for that answer. As you may know, Barr provide waste management services for both East and South Ayrshire Council. Due to the findings of the Tribunal, councils may have to provide more funding to Barr to provide waste services as the company can't operate under the terms of its previous contract. So can I ask what discussions the Scottish Government will have with both councils regarding the future of the company and waste management services in the area to ensure that the councils receive any extra funding that they require so that they don't impact on local services?
Minister.
I would just need to stress again to the member that it is not appropriate for Scottish ministers to comment on this matter. However, I would also wish to stress that CEPA works to ensure the safe management of all licensed landfill sites to protect the environment and communities.
Question number 6, Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government what role Scotland is playing during COP26 in relation to innovation and economic activity.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Achieving global climate change targets requires new ways of thinking about economic policy, finance and investment, as well as new instruments and interventions to make the change. We are working with partners and businesses from Scotland and around the world to deliver a COP26 programme that will accelerate change across these areas. Through our programme of events, ministerial and business engagements, we will showcase our strengths in innovation, trade and investment to a global audience. For example, Scotland's Climate Ambition Zone is hosting a programme of events during the COP26 fortnight, which is putting a spotlight on Scotland as a world leader in sectors such as decarbonising heat, circular economy, hydrogen and green skills. Further, in association with partners such as the Michelin Scotland Innovation Park in Dundee, we are highlighting innovations in the area of low-carbon transport, a key enabler for a net-zero economy. We will use COP26 as a platform to showcase and attract investment into Scotland's green investment portfolio, which will bring together market-ready projects worth £3 billion by 2022. We are participating in events covering natural capital, green ethical finance and finance for nature, providing a platform to address the crucial issues of financing a fair and just transition to net zero. By sharing our experiences across these sectors, we intend to galvanise action in the business community to help others on their journey to net zero. COP26 is not an end in itself,
Minister, can I please ask you to draw those remarks to a close?
I certainly will, and we will build upon this opportunity through delivering our national strategy for economic transformation.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop.
Can I thank the Minister for that very extensive answer to what was a very open question. Can the Minister say what the Scottish Government is doing to promote green hydrogen innovation, specifically at COP, and what action is being taken to advance the pace, the scale and the role of green hydrogen in our energy mix in the drive to cut carbon emissions?
Minister.
I'm grateful to Fiona Hislop for that supplementary, and I will try to as succinctly but as comprehensively answer it. The Scottish Government will shortly publish its 5-year Hydrogen Action Plan, which will set out the actions that the Scottish Government will take to support Scottish supply chain activity and drive the development of a low-cost hydrogen capability to meet that 5-gigawatt ambition by 2030. The Scottish Government's upcoming Hydrogen Action Plan will be supported by a 5-year £100 million programme of investment to help accelerate the development of the hydrogen economy in Scotland. The Scottish Scottish Government, in collaboration with Scottish Enterprise, have developed a series of hydrogen events during COP to showcase Scotland's expertise and innovation in hydrogen technology. We will be seeking opportunities during COP26 to strengthen our existing international partnerships and seek new collaborations to accelerate the growth of our shared hydrogen economies.
Question number 7, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what its plans are for active ventilation in classroom now that its inspection programme has been completed.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Guidance on reducing risks in schools makes clear the ongoing approach to ventilation that local authorities and schools should adopt. This guidance includes advice on identifying and implementing local approaches that balance need for fresh air in key parts of the school estate with the maintenance of adequate temperatures. Following completion of local authorities' initial CO2 monitoring activities, it is expected that CO2 monitoring will continue to play a role in supporting the implementations of the approaches set out in the guidance. And we are continuing to work with stakeholders, including the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland and the Scottish Heads of Property Services, to ensure that suitable longer-term strategies are in place across all local authorities.
Michael Mara.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I note the statistics she set out to the Education Committee. The Scottish Government has taken over a year and spent £10 million of taxpayers' money on alarms to let teachers know when to open the window, with no real regard for the sustainable active ventilation systems that we need. Real action would make schools safer environments by reducing COVID transmission rates and would also reduce education disruption. Can the Minister tell us how many classrooms failed inspection and what remedial action she would expect to now be taken?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I point Mr Mara to the fact that indeed the Scottish Government gave £10 million for local authorities recently, but that is of course in addition to the £90 million that was given previously in the year for such remedial actions, including dealing with CO2 monitoring exercises. The assessment outcomes that have came very much from the local authorities themselves have reported back that the remedial actions for these in the main have been very small. They have required to look at, for example, changes to repairing windows or no obstructions to ensure maximum opening. There have been very, very limited requirements for any further improvements than that, but where they have been required to be undertaken, they will be undertaken by local authorities. And of course, the Scottish Government continues to be in close contact with the local authorities to ensure that that monitoring is ongoing and, of course, the remedial action is undertaken.
Question number 8, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the 2019 exports statistics.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Through our Export Growth Plan, a trading nation, the Scottish Government is focused on supporting the growth of exports from 20% to 25% of GDP by 2029. The export statistics Scotland 2019 show strong growth in Scotland's exports before the economic shock of the global pandemic and the damage caused by the UK Government's reckless approach to EU exit. In 2019, Scotland's total exports of goods and services increased by 4.3% to £87.1 billion, including increases in the international exports of goods and services by 3.4% to £35.1 billion, and exports to the rest of the UK by 5% to £52 billion. The growth in exports to the rest of the UK was driven by an increase in electricity exports, helping to keep the lights on in England and Wales. More recent HMRC statistics only underline the negative impact of EU exit, as Scottish goods exports fell by 24% in the latest year to June 2021, compared to the equivalent period in 2019.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that extensive response. We welcome these statistics showing a 3.4% increase in Scottish exports. However, these statistics also show an increase in the proportion of goods exported to the rest of the UK, with the figure now increasing to 5%, £52 billion, which shows that 60% of exports from Scotland. Given the increasing importance of the UK market, does the Minister agree that any potential trade barriers between Scotland and the rest of the UK would risk significant economic damage?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I don't know if international trade is the strongest suit for the Conservatives to lead on, but let me see this very... On a note of consensus, England, Wales and Northern Ireland are important trade partners for Scotland, and I'm sure the Member will agree they will remain important trade partners for Scotland once we achieve independence.